bà mình anh sân cho bà tí đi đọc bây nâng ô sát đồ nâng cà mình bà chung rô la quý nghĩa bà bà mà chắc Giê-xu Cris con sông bà ông bà tiết bà bà đọc bà bà ọc nìa nông cà rìm trọng cầm thi ô sát đồ nì nâng chú bật chăm mây chú bật mây tăng bì cà chai chai bà bà tù cà rôm, cà chơi riêng, cà cha sinh đại nhân niệm đam bay ở bàn sau ta một nón và hạt tê và trung xong mong một tên bộ và mong tung cung đại cũng thuần là mong chỉ một tàu to đam bay ở con viên sau bắc tiếp nông ca quần là màu châu rùm rùm ao sa đầu nở cả mấy bị chun rùm lao viên và trung còn đôi chi ở cặp vị thi châu sang mai phong đài. Lord God, once again, thank you for the privilege to be here this evening to celebrate the resurrection and to celebrate the new life, which is Cambodian New Year as well. Lord, we ask your Spirit to come upon each one of us who prepare the program, start from the skit, singing, devotional, music and everything, Lord, we commit this in your hand. We know that you have good plan for all of us. We lift up everyone who are coming yet, Lord. Bless them so that way they have the safety and security during traveling to be here this afternoon. And also bless everyone here so that way we can have joy of food, fun, and fellowship, and as well as to witness the resurrection of Christ. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Today we have a privilege to have Dan and Ellen Seaborn. Ellen Seaborn is the son of Dan Seaborn. You might hear from time to time in the radio, and everywhere that people invited them him to have a speech. Ellen have some brochure and everything there. If anyone want to have that banner or the sign put in front of your house, that would be great too. And I will let Ellen touch base more detail on that. During his devotion. Ellen, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Nam. I'm excited to be here and share with you this afternoon and this evening. And like you said, I'm part of a ministry called Winning at Home. And we're a marriage and family organization. We're not far up the road here in Zealand. And you probably have at least seen the billboards of that look like those signs over there that say, wake up. There's coming up May 18 to 21, there's going to be a community revival. And we're really just calling people in Holland and Zealand, calling people to Christ. That's what that's going to be all about. So if you know people, some of the people in your family, your friends, people in your life who don't know God, it's a perfect place to invite them. Or if you know people that have been in the church, but they, like all of us, at times could grow deeper, that's going to be another thing that they'll be challenged for on that 4 days in May. So if you want to take that stuff, go ahead and grab it. But what I want to share with you tonight is my favorite passage of Scripture. Because as we're celebrating, I think it's so cool that you get to celebrate Easter at the same time as Cambodian New Year, because it's all about new life and fresh starts. And as I read through Scripture, that's what God is all about, all through the Bible. And so I want to read you, like I say, this passage is my favorite passage. And at first, as we read it, you might be going, well, I don't get why, but wait for the end. Because Paul is writing, this is in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Paul is writing to a church where there's some people in the church that have problems with each other. There was a business deal that went bad. There was a lawsuit. And Paul's writing and he's saying, when you take each other to court, you're basically saying that you only think that loving your neighbor and being patient, being forgiving and kind and all these things that God teaches us to do, when you decide to have a lawsuit when things go bad, you're saying that all that stuff only matters when life is easy. And so Paul writes this, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9. Don't you know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, or idolaters, or adulterers, nor male prostitutes, or homosexual offenders, or thieves, nor the greedy, or drunkards, or slanderers, nor swindlers, will inherit the kingdom of God. Now this verse right here is why this is my favorite passage. He says, that is what some of you were, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the Spirit of our God. And what Paul's writing here is something that applies no matter where we're at in our walk. Because I think there's a couple different ways that we can read this passage, and it depends on where we are in our journey with God. Sometimes when we feel like our past, the things that we've been a part of, the things that we've done, they disqualify us from serving God's kingdom, we read this passage and we're reminded that what we've done in the past, who we've been before, the things that have been part of our lives, that's not how God sees us anymore. And we read it this way. We think, that is what some of you were. And we're reminded that the things that we think in our lives that could keep God from ever being able to use us, that's not how He sees us anymore. Because that's who we were before we were washed, we were purified, we were sanctified by the work that God did in our lives. But I want to talk about something that's the other side of that, the other angle, because I think sometimes it's easy, especially those of us that have been in the church, we look and we kind of focus in on where other people are falling short. And if we're in that spot, if we're looking at the way other people are living their lives, and we're saying, well, hey, you can't be doing that, you can't live that way, you can't have your life be all about this, we can read it this other way, and we can say that that is what some of you, me, were before what God did in our lives. You see, I think sometimes we find ourselves in our journey of faith, we find ourselves kind of like the prophet Jonah, if you remember in the Old Testament. God called Jonah to go to this place and to preach to them because God said He was going to destroy Assyria. And so He told Jonah to go to Nineveh to preach. And Jonah didn't want to go there because Assyria was the worst place in the world. This was a place that was always torturing and tormenting their enemies, and Israel was one of their enemies. And Jonah didn't want to go to Assyria and preach in Nineveh because he was afraid that the same way God had forgiven him, that God would forgive Assyria. And so you know the famous story. Jonah tries to run the opposite direction and God gets a hold of him. This storm, he's thrown overboard. He's in the belly of a fish for a few days. And then finally he obeys and he goes to Nineveh. But the story of Jonah, when you read it, the message that he preached, he really only said five words. That was his message in the language he was speaking. It was five words long. He said, 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed. He was reluctant. He was mad. He didn't want to go. And after he preached throughout the city, God got a hold of people's hearts. And what happened is they repented, they called on God, and they asked, and God forgave. And the book of Jonah ends with Jonah being mad at God. He says, God, you see, this is why I didn't want to go to Nineveh. He said, because I knew that you were gracious and compassionate. I knew that you were slow to anger and you were full of love. And then you kind of get, he's ending and saying, I'm not happy about it. And I'm guessing that all of us in here have some time in our lives where we know that feeling. I want to tell you about that for me, what that looked like. I have a younger sister. She's 18, or she's at the time the story was 18. Now she's 21. She started dating a guy about when she was 18 that was really, really not a good guy. He was around here, he was known as being a pretty big drug dealer. He was manipulating my sister. He took advantage of her. He stole some things from her and from our family. And as this was unfolding, I was kind of upset at the guy.